As the waves crashed over the south coast in Wellington earlier this week, we were reminded again that we are a nation that lives by the sea. In fact, we have 15,000 k of coastline, the ninth longest in the world, and more than three quarters of us live within 10 k of it, which is amazing. But as sea levels rise, so too does the risk that the sea poses, not just here but globally. And we're looking at that this morning, picking up on an international study that's found 267 million people worldwide live on land where storms and flooding and sea rise will increasingly jeopardise their homes. It's likely these numbers are much, much higher. And even if we achieve the Paris Agreement of limiting global warming to under 2 degrees, we'll still get, wait for this, 50 centimetres of sea level rise by the turn of this century. 50 centimetres. And at least 9,000 homes in this country lie less than 50 centimetres above spring high tide levels. In a moment, we're meeting people whose beloved homes are under threat from the sea. That is a big conversation. But first, Professor Tim Naish from Victoria University is an expert in this field, co-leader of New Zealand's Sea Rise Programme too. He's with us, beaming in from our Wellington studio. Morena, Tim. It's nice to have you with us. Thanks for coming in.
Kia ora, John. Nice to be here.
Yeah, this is a big conversation, isn't it? I'm staggered by how many of us live really close to the sea.
Yeah, I mean, we in New Zealand, it's not surprising. We love the sea. Part of our really, really part of our national identity, and if you look globally,
yeah,
you know, there's a lot of people potentially exposed, as you said in your intro.
So if we manage to meet the Paris Accord, and that isn't even looking on at the moment, and we restrict our climate change temperature rise to less than 2 degrees, we're still looking at 50 centimetre sea level rise by the end of the century. Is that right?
Yeah, that is right. And I think people underestimate that. You know, we get these extreme events like storms and rainfall events, droughts and wildfires. But what we don't see is the tide slowly mm-hmm. creeping up. And the issue is, John, that the majority of the heat from global warming, more than 90% of it, has actually gone into the ocean. And, you know, the science is pretty well understood. And we all know that if we heat water, it expands. So the ocean has been rising as we've heated the planet. And an interesting factoid is that, you know, if we didn't have the ocean, the world would be 35 degrees warmer. So in a way, the ocean is our friend, but it's taking up all that heat. And the ice sheets are melting on the polar regions, Greenland and Antarctica, and the glaciers are melting. And we can't stop that train. You know, even if we bring our emissions to zero, we have baked in a certain amount of sea level rise we simply can't avoid.
The other thing, I've really enjoyed reading the notes for this interview. So thank you to you and our producers. But the other thing that we have in New Zealand is vertical land movement. I mean, we really have that in Wellington, for example, right? So not only is the sea rising, the land is moving too.
Absolutely. So in terms of New Zealand, local factors really matter. Where you live, you really matters. You could experience a different future. For example, if you live in the South Island, the coastline's pretty stable. But the lower North Island is subsiding at about 4 millimetres per year at the moment. So we get a double whammy of sea level rise. Not only is sea level rising at 3 millimetres per year, the coastline is subsiding at 4 millimetres per year. So that really brings forward a lot of the impacts and things we're worried about in terms of planning and preparing for them.
So this is such a big conversation. And I want to pick up on the sentence you just used, the planning and preparing for these things. But if we've already baked in some of this problem, and if the Paris Accord seems like a hopeful target, and that's 2 degrees, what can we do? I mean, either you're sitting in front of a blue screen, so you probably don't know what background you've got behind you, but it's a lovely picture of Orangeville Bay on a beautiful Wellington day.
Sure.
But that is low-lying, and as it is, that sand is trucked in, right? So what are we talking about for seaside communities like that?
Yeah, look, we're talking about unavoidable sea level rise, and I think the conversation needs to turn to adapting and preparing for that climate change, and particularly sea level rise, that we can't avoid. We've been very good in this country. We're a world leader in terms of carbon zero. When the Climate Change Commission has given us a good plan for achieving that and doing our part to get to the Paris Agreement. But we can't take our eye off the ball of adapting to climate change. And I really do think that's where the conversation needs to go in New Zealand in terms of climate change.
And can I push you, and you can say, no, John, I want to take the fifth on this, but what are the most effective things we can do? What should we be doing that we're not?
Oh, I don't want to take the fifth on that at all. I think, you know, at a national level, we have a very achievable plan for getting to carbon zero. And a lot of people go, well, what can I do? Isn't it up to politicians and governments? Well, it is. But it's pretty simple at home. Your biggest carbon footprint is around your transport and your heating. And so if you get a green provider for your electricity and you take public transport, and if you can afford it, an electric car, you will drop your carbon emission hugely, and that will make a massive difference, not only to the global picture, but to New Zealand's contribution to that. So we can all do our bit, but leaders need to lead as well.
And let's end on this fascinating fact that so we're working on 2 degrees. Even under 2 degrees, we're still looking at a 50 centimetre sea level rise by the end of this century, right?
Yes.
So there will be people alive today who are still going to be alive at the end of the century. The seas are going to rise by 50 centimetres in that time. And there are 9,000 New Zealand homes less than 50 centimetres above spring high tide levels?
Yes. Yes. I mean, the main point is that with 30 centimetres of sea level rise, which we will get in the next 30 or 40 years, that those big storm events, the 100-year storm event, becomes an annual event. It happens every year just with 30 centimetres of sea level rise in many places around New Zealand. So the sort of event
I just want to come in. We're looking at 50. With 30, the 100-year events happen every year.
Yes. So the sort of event we saw yesterday on the South Wellington coastline becomes the norm. And that wasn't as bad as a 100-year event.
Bloody hell.
Sorry to be the bearer of such.
Well, no, but we need to have these conversations, don't we? And actually, Tim, we're going to be joined by two people who will live. This is their lives. I mean, on Hector and Granty on the West Coast, the sea is eating their homes.
Yep.
So, right, these are big conversations. Professor Tim Naish from Victoria University, it's great to have you in. It was a resting conversation. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.